third meeting with the Hayes Group talking about our facilities study. Mr. Spacuzza usually runs this meeting. He's going to be a little bit late tonight, so we're going to get started. Mr. Hayes.
So what we're going to do at this point is allow the board members to talk with each other and talk to us and talk to school administrators about your thoughts, comments, questions about the master plan options that were shared with the board last month. And again, that information, if you needed to see it again, is in tab two of your binder. Everybody has a binder in front of them. You just have to go to tab two. But really, the board has not had, we did not discuss them at length last month, the master plan options and the recommended master plan options. So perhaps one of the things that would be worthwhile would be to go over the recommended master plan options for the board to consider. And the first was option 1B, which was keep all elementary schools, move all fourth graders to NAMS for a 5-4 intermediate elementary school, and move sixth grade to IMS, and then renovate the elementary schools in order for them to provide equity in the buildings. Option 3C was to close two elementary school buildings. And again, if you want to find that, it's about 4 or 5 pages in on tab two. If you go to tab two, open that up, and then scroll in, you'll eventually find a list of master plan options with 4 of them highlighted in yellow. And so option 3 was closing 2 elementary schools. NAMS becomes a 4th and 5th intermediate elementary school. 6th grade also moves to IMS without the need for additions. And the remaining K-3 population, it gets reassigned to the remaining 3 elementary schools. Option 8 was, in that option, we were moving NAMS, we were moving the 6th grade once again to IMS. We were going to renovate and add to Neil Armstrong Middle School so that it would be a 3-4-5 elementary center. And then we were going to close the existing elementary schools and build a new K-2 primary center. And again, we looked at 4 potential site locations for those. The ones we were recommending was either in the open fields at NAMS or on the Franklin Elementary School property. And then option 9, again, we were moving 6th grade to IMS. NAMS would just become a 4-5 intermediate elementary school, and you would build a new K-3 elementary center and then close your existing elementary schools. And again, that new K-3 facility could be built either at NAMS or at Ben Franklin. So what we want to do is maybe ask each board member if we could go around, if you like, and maybe just share your thoughts or opinions on any of the options and any of the pros and cons you see with those.
I'm going to go first, just for clarity's sake. And I think I'm speaking for the board when I say this, but our whole purpose with this study was to find information so that we could give it to the strategic plan committee so that they could then come up with a recommendation to the steering committee along with the facilities people to make a decision about this whole process. So if you're under the impression that we are going to choose one of these or move forward right now, we are not. We wanted you to, and you have provided us with a lot of information, and we're going to forward that information to our subcommittee under the steering committee, which is the facilities, and allow them to then make recommendations. And because this is a long-range plan, I don't think we're in any position at this point to make any decision about what we're going to do next year other than needed maintenance, possibly. So if you were under the impression, I've said that before, I know I did it one of the previous meetings, but I hope you're not under the impression that we're going to move forward with any of these options right now. We are going to go through our strategic plan and then make a decision. And we're going to use all this wonderful information as a basis for those decisions. But I actually think it's premature for us to go around the room and say what we're, there are a lot of things in here that I'm interested in, but that's me. And, you know, and we have to, I think, we've made a commitment to the strategic plan. And so that's, I believe that's where we're going. Now, any other board member can jump in here and confirm or say you want to do something
else. Mrs. Dobas, may I respond to what
sure.
you said? Again, I want to make clear, we have no preconceived notion that you're going to develop a consensus on these options. That's not why I raised the question.
Okay.
So the options are there, and you don't have to make a decision on the master plan option. The reason I simply offered the forum was the board hasn't really talked about master plan options, to my knowledge. And so if you, as a board, thought that would be helpful, you can do that. If you don't think it would be helpful, then you don't have to.
Well, I'm not going to put, anyone can say anything if you want to jump
in. No, I totally agree with you. I thought this was a lot of, this can be used for the Curriculum and Instruction Committee as we start to plan out facilities, gives us some groundwork on how this can all be, what option, are there additional options that weren't looked at based on some data that we were given or some other points. I also believe that, the student experience is another thing that needs to delve into this and look at this and have some input into where it is. Those are three committees on the strategic plan that are sub buckets, as Dr. Walsh would say, we need to look to them as the community as a whole, as where we are asking their input to move Bethel Park in what direction we're moving them in. So I wholeheartedly agree that at this point in time, I think it's premature to even discuss options 1 through 11 on here, because I don't want to hold back the strategic plan. I don't want to hold back those subcommittees, and I don't want to pigeonhole them into something that the board thinks, or a majority or a minority of the board thinks, is where we should be going. I want an open discussion with the strategic plan.
Mr. Spicuzza?
Yeah, I agree with you, Mrs. Dobas, about the fact that we're not moving ahead at any particular moment today, tomorrow, or in a week. But I think that, you know, we were elected to make some decisions, and we can't defer everything down the road to all the committees. They should hear our input, and they should understand what we think. I mean, that's what are we doing here if we're not going to offer our opinions, right? I mean, we have to offer our opinions if we're just going to sit here. I mean, I think Mr. Hayes and their team has done a really fine job getting more information than we would have ever asked for with what we paid for. I really believe that. And I think there's a lot of good options here for us to consider. Again, not making a decision today, but I don't think also that we should just keep kicking the can down the road to the committees. Yeah, sure, they're gonna help us make the decision. But you know, there's nothing wrong with us expressing our opinions and stating what we feel is a good direction.
I agree with that. I just don't want to pigeonhole them. We've talked about that before, and saying too much or too little, or too much in a situation, and pigeonholing those committees into thinking it's a preconceived notion, which is what we did not want to do.
Yeah, you could look at it the opposite way, though, where then everything's fair game, and you know, we could be there for months and years trying to figure out how that all works out. So I believe that there needs to be some direction from the board, at least. Some sort of direction. I mean, we just leave it wide open. We're going nowhere, even with this strategic committee.
I mean, and I So far, we're all right. You know, one time we thought we had to make some really quick decisions. We realized we do not. And that was as we went into the...
That was as a result of...
Yeah, so again, things have changed. But one thing that's clear here, and not to get ahead of ourselves in regards to what we're going to look like, and the information, I'm sorry, I'm just highlighting on the one chart sheet, you know, some of the buildings and the occupancy levels that they have currently and what the potential it could have. One thing we know, we know ourselves because we see it all the time, and the community as a whole may not realize that our enrollment numbers have gone down. And I know when Dr. Steuben gets here, we'll have more in-depth conversation about that, but I could see how that natural step is. Your enrollments was this level, it's this level, it will be this level in 5-10 years. You know, do we have to make changes? Probably, and it will take its time and natural course. It's just the information is here, all, you know, and again, some changes are going to be made. We've talked about before, those of us have been around where I am long enough to remember where IMS was 6, 7, 8, all right? And if we were going to do something as something within a year or two, obviously some improvements for IMS have to be made. So we will get through that process. And again, once we make a step like that, what does that do down the road with the other buildings? So we do have a lot, but I think like Mrs. Rowland, and we were saying, we probably have some kind of conversation, you know, in regards to what, not immediate direction, but just kind of what path are we, you know, maybe we're on a fork in the road, I don't know. And Doc, this, I know it's tough for you because you're just jumping into this. But, you know, when we talked about this, when IMS is two-thirds occupied, you know,
right.
Using it to its best level.
Right.
You know, where NAMS is set up best for two grades, Mr. Hayes had said that in previous meetings, you know what I mean? Maybe this goes back to Mr. Spicuzza saying, we got to probably put some traction behind some area.
Well, and from your report last month, that what you just said, Mr. Modrak, was very obvious that IMS is not at anywhere near capacity. So, you know, we were referring to whether we're going to move sixth grade up to IMS. And also the glaring information about the age of our buildings and how much money would have to be put into our buildings in order to keep them going versus the cost of building another structure to house all of those. And I think that you clearly, I mean, if we're giving this information to another committee, I mean, that's what jumped out to all of us a month ago. And I think that's what would jump out to a facilities committee too. And Mr. Spicuzza and Mr. Fierst would be at the forefront of that subcommittee too, you know, so.
It just, I feel we really never, because there's been a lot going on, you know, as we all are aware. And it just, we, as a group, we really never had a thought or discussion what we'd like to see. You know, exclusive of, you know, again, no one's signing any contracts here today. We know that. But we do have these issues of using the buildings to their full capacity. Sooner or later, we have to deal with it. Because it's not fair for everybody to sit there to operate IMS under a two-thirds capacity, where, you know, we're losing money off of that. You know, again, there's a lot involved, I know that, but, you know, that's something if that decision is ever made by this group or the next group, then that's a domino effect that takes place from that point forward, along with the fact that we have buildings that need money put into them, and that's that big decision. But I don't know.
I think one of the things that really came to light to me is the fact that if we move the sixth grade there, they can have like an academy for the sixth grade. So it eases some fears of moving kids into groups that you may not be comfortable with. That sort of bridges that and makes sense to me that works really, really well. So I think, like I said earlier, there's a lot of really good information that came out of the study that if we didn't see that, you know, we might have made a decision going, no, we don't want to do that, right? So thank you for that. And I think that's truly important for us, the community, the administration to take a look at and help guide us as we move forward through this process. Sorry. Connie.
Much property, what schools don't. So I think it's good that you know what you have to work with.
May I ask, I'm sorry, Dr. O'Rourke, and I lose track of timeframe, was IMS the two grades since you've been here, or you can recall it ever being three grades? Under your time?
It was actually when in 1999 is when IMS became the 7-8 and Neil Armstrong became the 5-6. It started in the fall of 1999.
Okay. Thank you.
And Dr. O'Rourke, that was for the purposes of making that 5-6 building. I apologize, not, I just want to get all the information out there. That was to make that NAMS building 5-6, and there were some educational reasons for the moving fifth, other than just space at the elementary schools.
I believe the driving force, I hired as the first middle school assistant principal at Neil Armstrong. At the time, the decision had already been made, and I was hired to open that school. But I believe so that was where the influx of students were. And Neil Armstrong at the time was an elementary school. So it was to take one of the elementary schools, there were six elementary schools, K through five. They took that and made that the 5-6, and then they moved those kids to the other elementary schools there, and then sixth grade dropped down, fifth grade went up, and that's how that occurred. So there was some capacity of keeping kids younger at the time. Some of the things that I heard at the time was that sixth grade, there was something that the Bethel Rec used to do was called a teen center.
Yeah.
And there was some concern about having sixth grade with eighth grade socially, developmentally, age appropriateness. So you guys don't want to give me a lavalier mic because you know I'll never shut up. But nonetheless, so there was a lot of different things that went on, that what was more, was a fifth grader more like a sixth grader, or was a sixth grader more like an eighth grader? And that was the premise at that time. But I think the driving force really was there was so many kids and so many at certain
places. There was also a discussion, I think at that time there were two models, Dr. O'Rourke. Some schools were going 3-4. And another group was going 5-6, and the educators were trying to determine what would work best for us.
Yeah, that's what I just wanted the public, too, that is listening to have some background on, as Mr. Rajark was asking, too, the reasons for some of this that was going on. I thought at that time part of it was a capacity issue at IMS.
It was. And then the other thing is, too, is you had a 5-6 at Upper St. Clair.
Right.
You had a 5-6 at Gateway,
yeah.
School District. So it was, I think there was a study that was done about what would be in the best interest of Bethel Park at the time.
Okay. Thank you very much.
Thank you. But my recollection, you know, working the job that I did, was it was an enrollment issue that was that set it off, which again, it's an enrollment issue, is why we're having this conversation again.
Right.
It's the other way. Instead of too much, now too less.
That's what I thought it was, because at the, you know, several years prior to that, you had closed McMillan and Logan and redistricted, yeah. And we were still growing at max capacity at those elementary schools. So. Okay.
But the problem at Neil Armstrong is that we're running two different programs.
I agree. And the
we're
bell
running
schedule
an elementary program for fifth grade, and we're running a middle school program for sixth grade with two different bell schedules, et cetera, et cetera. So to move sixth grade to the middle school at IMS makes a lot of sense, and to move fourth grade up to, so that there's an element, so. Because there's always been tension between those two academic models in that building. I mean, I think you would agree. It was, there is, one is it's a transitional elementary school, and the other is basically divided as more of a 9-period day. One has blocks, fifth grade has blocks. I think even though something that the board has to take into account is sixth grade, the transition to sixth grade to IMS, as far as this collective bargaining unit will be relatively simple. There is going to be ramifications. Fifth grade does not currently follow the CBA for the elementary schools. There's a component of the collective bargaining unit just for Neil Armstrong there will be implications that you just need to be aware of.
Thank you. And that's...
That's true.
True, but contracts coming up.
But see, after all that, we actually had some direction.
And I just wanted most people to understand that, you know, when I went here, and I believe Mrs. Doba's also, IMS was 6, 7, 8.
Right. Yeah. It was.
Correct.
When I went to Bethel, we had a junior high school.
You went to Park Avenue.
Well, we had 9.
You didn't go to the old school. You didn't go to the old school house. People don't know Park Avenue was there.
We're not going to find out if the roads were paved or not.
The old Red Dog. Sorry. Sorry, Mrs. Dobas.
Sorry, Mrs. Dobas. But sorry. I mean, I just wanted people to understand that it's not new to put sixth grade at IMS because it was housed there for years.
So going, and I'm sorry to continue with this, and I know we want to get doctor talking about.
No, you're fine.
But on what I'm saying, Mr. Hayes, is like when you went through, you even said IMS can support up to 1,000 to 1,200, but right now our numbers we're looking, if we were to put the three together, still takes us under your capacity with preferred class sizes, which you list 6 to 8 as one teacher, 26 kids per classroom. All right, and that would even take us at 988, and that we're still, I think, we're going to be under that.
That's correct.
So we're not going to be on top of each other. There's going to be room, and if we talked about, I think, who mentioned the sixth grade academy, you know, somehow, again, we're getting maybe a little ahead of ourselves in vision what it could look like if that's the direction it ends up going. But point being is there's enough space up there with our enrollment numbers now, and what doctor will be able to tell us what the future will look like for us for a while.
That's correct. That's correct. Yeah, there is plenty of capacity at IMS to move the sixth grade up there. And there's also the layout of IMS allows the sixth, seventh, and eighth grade to actually have their own areas of the building. And for the sixth grade, it actually would be isolated on the first floor of the building. So.
And then seventh, eighth would be upstairs? Okay. That's important. That's what it was?
That's the way it was.
I never got past the office at all.
Yeah, that's, I mean.
Walk in sixth grade was to the left, and then seventh and eighth grade.
Okay.
That was.
Right was the industrial arts and home.
Right.
Right, that was done. I mean, the industrial arts and that kind of stuff was already there. That move that put sixth grade on the bottom floor was not done until the late 80s, early 90s. When I went there, we were all over the building. So the sectioning of it was done when they flipped the cafeteria from upstairs to down.
And the cafeteria size, because I don't have those specifics. Do you recall offhand how much that cafeteria can sit?
Off the top of my head, I do not, but I don't think that will be an issue of bringing the kids in and having enough space.
Okay. Thank you.
Sure. I was actually going to ask, and Dr. Walsh, not to put you on the spot, you've been here less than 2 weeks, but was there anything, I mean, you'll be leading the strategic planning effort, you know, is there anything it would help you in that process, or in what you envision that process to be, to hear the board talk about it all?
No, but thanks for the opportunity, and one of the things that I think I heard already tonight is that this study will provide good fodder for all of the subcommittees, because there's pieces of the future, pieces of the options that are here that speak to a curricular opportunity, a student experience opportunity,
right,
facilities opportunity, All of it speaks to budget and financial opportunities or necessities. So that I wanted to, everybody to know that that's really, this will be really useful for all of the groups. But I also don't want it to be, you know, the thing that they only focus on as a group, because there's other things that we should be considering. Whether or not the buildings can accommodate it would be a secondary question. The primary question is, what should we be looking at as an organization for the next 3 to 5 years? The administration needs to spend some time with this too.
Mm-hmm.
And very shortly in my tenure, realizing that there's a lot of opportunity and difference and uniqueness about these options that we have to explore. And I feel like we want to be able to report back both to the board and maybe even to the subcommittees what we see administratively or, you know, as an organization, and how we could maximize these options, what we would want to, what we could do with them.
Yes.
That we're going to favor one over the other. It's just that what could we do with this, a sixth grade academy? What could we do with a middle school model? What, you know, et cetera.
Yes. Very good. All right, with that, it's actually a very good segue into the discussion of demographics. So I'm going to introduce Dr. Shelby Stuman and provide just a little information about him. Dr. Stuman, it was a long time professor at Carnegie Mellon University, teaching in statistics and demography. Graduated a lot of students who have gone on to help demographics across the country. Dr. Stuman has done many, many demographic studies for school districts in the area and beyond over many, many years. What I can tell you from my own personal experience, I think I've worked either with districts who hired Dr. Stuman directly, or he was a part of our team in at least, I would say, 8 school districts. And in all of them, his 10-year studies were remarkably accurate over time. You know, the scenario that he indicated to the school district was the most likely, oftentimes tracked very close to that. So with that, I'll introduce and yield to Dr. Stuman. He can walk us through the report, which, again, everybody should have a separate document that has demographic school analysis. And again, we aren't necessarily going to go page by page, but if he needs to refer to something, he can. So, Dr. Stuman.
Thanks. The first thing I want to say is to acknowledge the people in the school district and the municipality for being very generous and giving me the data I needed.
Okay. We good? I doubt if we're going to need too much of the mic. Anyway, I got the housing data readily, and while there isn't a massive amount, there's an interesting amount, and it also gives us opportunity to know where it sits. There's virtually no vacant land to build new houses, so if impacts come through housing, it'll probably be on turnover of existing stock with empty nesters and our older residents. But I see no evidence of that to date, and so that'll have to wait until it does show up. Anyway, there are several pieces that are critical here. The overall themes are population waves, and that's due to the fertility spike, if you will, and of the baby boom, and you're aware of the baby boom, but right after that came a baby bust. That's what basically turned your enrollments from positive to negative for 20 years. So it's not a small phenomenon, and it's documented in here in detail. And then following the baby bust is the echo boom. And critical for your future will be whether the echoes cohorts stay or get replaced. or do not. If they do not, then there'll be no migration and there'll be no major impact on births at all. But we'll, I'll try to go through that. You can interrupt and ask questions at any point if you wish.
Try to move his microphone closer to his mouth, please.
Yeah, something I'm getting.
We can't hear
information
very well.
That they can't hear him.
I can probably do that.
Oh, that's better.
Yeah, I fog up usually with my mask. Okay, the first, that's let's better. Just get to the results instead of trying to go around a bush. Table one, and I'll mainly go through tables and occasionally go into the text to give you a clue about the nature of the analysis, and you can actually see some of it yourself. I'll try to point that out. The first thing that was really important to me was that after 30 years, or including the last 5 years, Bethel Park finally has an increase in births. From 90 to 95 to 2000 to 2005, there was a decrease in births. Massive. On the first wave, 322. On the second wave, 144.
Everybody, the tables are at the very back, so it's easier to work from the back and just work 8, 7, 6, 5, 4, et cetera.
There's a whole set of tables at the back end of the report.
After page 41.
They're not embedded inside the text.
Yeah. We'll just let them get to that.
Yeah. So table one is critically important. Give you 30 years of births, or 29 to be exact. And then cut it into five-year periods to make it useful to talk about. And then look at the average is what we're doing. So basically, births went from 2056 in the 1994 period to 1724. That's negative 322, or 3332, I believe. And then the next one is a negative 144. And the next one is a negative 222. So births are falling. These aren't minor things. These are big drops. And births dropped hard for 15 years. And then you got a stabilization, and births did not change for 10 years. They stayed at the 1358. If you look at 2005 to 9 in the middle quadrant, that time zone, you'll see 1358. Anybody see that?
Mm-hmm.
Right below it is 1357. So there's a one-person difference in the 2 5-year birth periods. Extreme stability. I expected the same for 2015 to 2018 or 19. Instead, we got a jump to 1531, 174 increased births. So then the question is, what does that hold for Bethel Park schools and elementary enrollments? And we'll try to get to that. Is it the beginning of a long-term sort of swing, or is it just a bump in the road? Not an easy task to discern, but I think we've fairly well got it mapped out. And so if you go to single years, the average in 1994 was 411. Then it dropped to 345, then it dropped to 316, then it dropped to 271. 271 is the plateau that held for 10 years. And then, last 5 years, it jumped to 306, a jump of 35. So you can see the jump in the bottom quadrant. Now that's a surprise and something that analysts have to take into account, because you can't assume which way it's going. You've got to try to figure out what happened here. And I think we pretty well know. Table 2 gives you the births by age. So if you're just dealing with population, it's not very interesting anyway. But once you cut it by age, it becomes much more intriguing. And demography is exceptionally so. You can make a lot of deductions off of that. So the shaded area is the baby bust. On the right side of that is the boom, which didn't last very long because we began after it was well underway. And then below that is the echo boom. Normally, I put the numerical changes in there, but I didn't this time. So what's going on is, the first thing I look at is how much, where are the births occurring? And the greatest number of births is in 30, 34. Second greatest is in 25 to 29. That holds up for all 30 years, regardless of which direction the overall births are going. On the other hand, 25 to 29 dropped 3%, and 35 to 39 increased 3%. So what happened is Bethel Park was well ahead of the curve in terms of delayed childbearing. Now, that shouldn't surprise you, I guess, but it was already at 37.63 in 1990. We're talking about 30 years ago. And then over this period of 30 years, it has increased, the 30 and above has increased by 4%, and below, obviously, by negative 4. And I just told you where the drops were mostly occurring. That doesn't mean that we aren't still getting delayed childbearing. We are. It's just, it's been there for a very long time. Now, the question arises, does delayed childbearing mean fewer children? And the answer is no. So you can look at table, we'll look very quickly. You look very quickly at table 3 and table 4. Table 3 tells you the dark shade is the baby boom, and it lasted 20 years, and it was huge. You can see the number of children in 1957. Average 3.8 kids a woman, a mother. By the baby bust, the lighter shade, that shows up in 1976, that number was 176, less than half of that. Instead of going on about it, we'll just note that these big fertility differences, not just in a single year, these are the unique births in the entire century, but what's important is it's got a whole stream of births on bordering it on the upper and lower side in each case. You got 20 years of high births in the baby boom, you got 10 years of low births in the baby bust, and you got 20 years of higher booms, higher births in the echo. In table 4, this gives you the range.
Excuse me one second, could I ask a question, Dr. Stewart? It's interesting to me to look at this statistically, and now it makes a lot more sense when you look at potential births down the road, because the number of potential women of bearing age is not there. They're half of them are gone. So statistically, as we continue through your charts, I'm going to think that you're going to show us that. You have so many more births in the 50s, so 20 years later and on, they're just going to go, and then it's going to drop off the cliff.
Focus is distracted. Keep going.
Yeah, sorry.
No, that's fine. Table 4 tells you for white and non-Hispanic whites, which is Bethel Park, 96% white. 1% black, 1% Hispanic, and 1% 2-plus races. So this is the table we need to look at. And the key is, what's the total fertility rate of these women across the last 45 years? The answer is 1.7 to 1.9. It doesn't change much. And so with delayed childbearing, it doesn't matter. They're going to have 1.7 to 1.9 kids on average, delay or not. Just comes the timing change. So we'll try to take that into account a bit. And then table 5 gives you the what I call the population waves. 90, 2000, 2010 for the nation, for Pennsylvania, for Allegheny County, and shortly I'll show you for Bethel Park School District. The big bull numbers are the baby boom. The shaded numbers are the baby bust, and the ones in between is what I call the transition cohort. which is really the leading edge of the baby bust. So it's 15 years there. What you'll see if you compare them is that the baby bust is smaller in all cases. If you go to the bottom, you can see the difference in there. We're talking millions, not a few hundred. Same thing occurs in 2010, except the age changes from 2025 to 3035. So this baby bust is aging over time, and as it ages over time, it affects the fertility rates of the entire group of women. In Pennsylvania, you see the same thing, exactly the same thing. In Allegheny County, it's a little less. In the first wave, there are two cases or three that doesn't hold. So that's something to be aware of and watch if that also shows up in Bethel Park. But the key of what I'm trying to get at is these are waves in the population. They will have effect by themselves with a constant fertility rate. Means the number of births can fluctuate with the number of women. Fertility rate won't matter much. It's relatively constant. So now we're going to look at these differences in the number of women in the, by cohort. I made a map in table six, which tells you we know where they're at in real time. So the capital BBs are baby boom, the little BBs and TC are the baby bust, the EBs are the echo booms. We know where they'll be and at what age throughout this time zone, and including up to 2025, part of the future. So table seven gets us into the population of women in Bethel Park over time by age. There are two things really important here. One is you see the bold where it exists generally is positive, but more importantly, the baby bust, which is the shaded area on the left side, has massive numbers. So what's happening is one cohort's being replaced by another cohort. If you looked at Bethel Park in 2000, 2010, and then upcoming 2020, you just see numbers. But when you cut it by age, you see what's really going on underneath it. And the 20s all negative, and the 30s are positive. Yeah.
Just a clarification. By cohort, he means a group of people in the table above. You know, the 15 to 19 is a cohort. So replacement of cohort means one group replacing the other. Just thought it might help.
Yeah, it's an age cohort. So you lump together 5 years of births and let them age over time and see what happens. If you go back to table two, you can see what happens. Births are heavier in the baby boom years, lighter in the baby bust years. That was table two, if I can find the bloody thing. There we go. Okay, so, for example, in table two, the 25 to 29-year-olds in 1990, there were 590 births. But on the 30-34, there was 885 births. If you shift that forward 5 years, you see the 25 to 29 in shaded area has 458 births. So what we're looking at is the difference between those, and that's, what, 42? If we go over to the right, 30 to 34, is being 885 of them is being replaced by 679 women. That's a massive drop. Huge. And so you're going to see, these are births, so you're going to see the cohorts move across time, upper and lower, and you'll see births move with them. Not perfectly, but they basically move with them. This is what accounted for the drop in births. You just replace baby boomers with baby bust women, all right? If we look at, there's two aspects of this table seven, which relates to Bethel Park. First has to do with these waves. So you'll see the shaded areas for the most part. If you compare aging, you can take 2024, 1990 and go to 3034 in 2000. And you'll see the shifts in the cohorts across time. I apologize for not putting a number of numerical shifts in, but you can calculate it directly. If you go to the upper part of the table at the top, this is in the text. You can see a number 929, then that goes, if you age it out 10 more years, 632, and you take it 5 more years, 845. Do you see those numbers?
Are we in table 7 or table 2?
7.
Table 7, and the age cohort is 25 to 29.
Okay. Well, yeah, but that's at the end. We're going to trace them backwards to when they were 15 and 20. And it turns out that if you watch the migration here, the reason the numbers dropped in the 25 to 29 is because this cohort was depleted 10 years before that. And you can look at the migration. Migration is calculated in square brackets in quadrant 1 and quadrant 2 and 3. So this is the first time I've ever chased them across 2-3 time zones, but this is why you're one of the reasons you're not going to get another bump in births. Because now that one's in 2019. The question, who's sitting there? And the text compares the 2015 and 2019. 2015, the population sitting there is what's critical for the births from 15 to 18. That gives you the bump, increased births. 2019, the question is, and that's for the future, 2021, 22. Question is, what's happening with them and what does that look like? And I'm an eternal optimist, but I looked at this pretty hard, and you just can't build a case that it's going to, the verse is going to repeat. And the way you do that is by comparing these two columns. All right, so if you go to, let's take 35 to 39 and walk it across. The thing that overloads on top of the population waves is age. Women exit at a much higher rate in their 20s, and they enter, we're talking about Bethel Park, in their 30s. And this is across the entire state of Pennsylvania that I've observed. That is, you're getting net out migration in the 20s, getting net in migration in the 30s, and the issue is how do they balance out? So what you see right here is on the left side of quadrant 2 is the drop in the number of women in the baby bust. It drops 300, almost 500, and then 600. Isn't that?
Can I jump in? I think in the interest of time, because we've got some other things, I think in my mind, if anybody else questions it, I think Shelby's established his methodology is very thorough. And so,
and compulsive.
I think we're good with your methodology, and it would probably more helpful to just get to the conclusions.
Well, this is one of them in this table. If you look at those two columns, you're going to see, and I did the comparison in the text, look at them very carefully and give which one has the advantage. And in the 20, 25, 30, and 35, turns out that the advantage went to 2015 only once at 2025. Advantage went to 2019, 25, 29, 30, 34, 35, 39. By that I mean that you can't expect them to have the same number of births in the future, next 5 years, that they had in 2015 to 18. So this is consequential. I mean, it looks dull, but it isn't. And that's when, as I was trying to figure out what went on, I chased that cohort back and found out that it got depleted, that 25 to 29 and 19 got depleted 10 years before. Mm-hmm. as it dropped from 929 to 632. It was a massive drop. And then it gained some back. That's the 20s now. They're up. They're moving out. And in the 30s, they got part of it back, so 32 to 845. It just wasn't enough. And, another thing relevant to Table 8 is the preschoolers. We can deduce net migration of preschoolers. The key is the last three periods, 10, 15, and 19. We see an in-migration of preschoolers of 28 to 34 per year. So how do you know? Well, you take the census and you ask how many children are less than age 4. You take the births from a different database and ask how many kids were born here. The difference gives you the net migration, in or out. That's what this table does. So we can anticipate, you know, a fairly steady stream of people moving into the district with preschool children. It's about 10%. The next one is table 9 and then 9 ABCD by elementary, middle, lower middle, upper middle, and high school. We're just going to cover the overall. But in essence, let me tell you the logic real quick, and then I'll give you the results. Logic is the following. It's a counterfactual. It says, what if nobody migrated, in or out? Then the difference in enrollment would be the number of graduating seniors in the spring and the number of entering kindergartners in the fall. If we then look at the actual enrollment change and subtract the what I call the exit entry exchange, the senior kindergarten, then we get the migration, and we get its direction as well. It's an algebraic equation. It's straight up. You can look at the text, and it turns out that's quite important for looking at what to expect, because I thought originally, and I've been working on this a while, that if you bump the births up, that will edge its way into the elementary school and ultimately cascade on up to the middle schools and so on. But the thinking was that enrollment will increase even in the first 5 years. Well, that's not necessarily true, because if you take this senior class, it's about 400 or 350. If you take the kindergarten class, it's less than 300. So if you take the two ends, you're going to still drop. You've got elementary growing, you've got the senior high decreasing in enrollment, and the question, the outcome for the total school district is, what's the mix? What's the delta? So that's one of the few things. The other one that I want to highlight is actually summarized in the bottom of this one and then table 12. So let's look at the bottom here. The column C at the very bottom is what I call the exit entry exchange. That's seniors exit, kindergartners come in. You can look at that at every educational level. Grade 4 kids go out, kindergartners come in. That's the elementary side of it. And you can go all the way for each class. And when you sum them up, they'll equal this. Can't be otherwise. So it's a way to cross-check your calculations. Anyway, what's going on here is you had 173 people move into the district between 15 and 20, 291 in the prior 5 years, for a total of almost 500 kids moving in. Now, this is very strict. This isn't moving in from necessarily outside. If they drop out of school, they're an exit. If they come in kindergarten or grade 1, that's an entrance in this calculation. And yet, the student enrollment declined 350 in the last 5 years, 444 in the prior, and overall, virtually 800. Why? The answer is in the without migration piece, because there was 1,259 losses in the exit entry. If that goes up, you get 795, the decline. Table 12 gives us a summary of this. Get there. This gives you your 795, it gives you 444 and 351, and it tells you where they came from, elementary, middle school, lower or upper, and high school. It It also gives you the breakdown and the bold print right in the middle, plus 464 kids coming in total. Over in the far right, 1259 exit entry losses. And the remaining is about 800 decline in enrollment. Another way to look at this is with retention ratios, which I do. And this is where we get an idea about how much migration is across time, across the scale here. 986 out of 1,000 kids will show up for kindergarten. And then you'll get 100,028 show up per 1,000 in the first grade. So somebody's coming in, right? If we multiply those together, you'll get what's on page 12, 1,014, and then you can multiply the same number times grade 8, it'll turn out to be 8% higher than your birth. So it's like compound interest, it's just not very leveraging very high. Enrollment is in table 13, I won't go over it. But it's your 795. These are just raw counts for the last 10 years. I try to give you a number summary and then the range as well as the average number of students and the average grade size. In 14, we've got the alternative schools. So homeschool increased slightly from 65 to 78. And then you got the COVID-19 spike. It jumped to 121. No reason to think it's going to stay there, but that's a reality check. Cyber charters moved from 43 to 53, which isn't very much, and then with COVID-19 jumped to 133. What's bad about this is two features. One is charter cyber charter schools are notoriously bad in most cases. They don't graduate people on time. It's not unusual. You get 50% graduation rates. I've tried to follow them in at least 3 to 5 districts. I can't even follow them. I don't know what's happening to them. The school district doesn't know either, and I'm not sure that the cyber charters know. My thinking has always been somebody needs to talk to the state Congress, the Senate and House, and get them to allow you not to pay until they tell you what happened to the kid. It's just reasonable accounting. Anybody, I'd agree to that.
And we certainly do.
And then the private parochial stayed the same. It actually dropped a little bit. So you see the difference down at the bottom. It was 413 for all three kinds of alternative schooling. Then it turned to 535, over 122, as a matter of fact. Now, just to commend you slightly, I did table 14A, which was the only data that gave us longer-term enrollment numbers by type of alternative. And what you see is the normal thing, that is cybers grew from 50 to 70, and then they tailed off and went back to 50 and 40s. So I can only credit that to the school district working to try to make sure there are options for these children or kids. And then COVID came in and messed it up, but hopefully it won't last long. All right, new housing, you had a little bitty bump in 2015 to 2018 of 87 homes being built. Before that, in 11 to 14, there were, 19? And then 19 and 20, there were 12. So what you get is a very low number, and then a bump, and then another very low number. And I sort of wrote that off originally, but I don't think I should, because it finally dawned on me. The houses were built in 15 to 18, the new ones. And the increased births were in 15 to 18. I do not believe it's total coincidence. Can't document that. I doubt that 87 moms created 174 children My daughter is a new mom, so I mean, I say this affectionately, with her fourth kid, by the way. And an aside, she told us when she was growing up that she was not going to be an old mother and father like we were. We're in the 30s. We had delayed childbearing until I got through grad school. And then it took a while to take. But she's a doctor now, and she is exactly in the 30s. She had to eat crow. What is important here is that Bethel Pines is going to be built. It's got 19 lots, and that's all that we know of in terms of new developments. Basically, vacant land is gone. And so you're probably not going to get it. Even if this were true, in 15 to 18, you will not get a bump in the next 5 years. About all you're going to get is Bethel Pines, 19 lots. That isn't enough to make a difference. It's not trivial, but it won't move enrollments up and hold them there. It takes a continuous stream of new homes, and you got a little bit of that from 15 to 18, but then it dissipated. And I think there were several plans here, but I'm not certain. Now we get to the payoff, which is the projections themselves. Scenario one, so I tell you up front, scenario one is the second most likely. Scenario four is most likely. Scenario two is not possible, but it's put there to try to tell you, if you were to have births going at this rate, what's the number of students you would have 10 years out? A sort of a cap, if you like. And scenario three, maybe it is a drop down to the prior level of births. Not unreasonable that could happen, but I don't see necessarily as happening.
I'm sorry, can you repeat which one's most likely?
Four.
Four, thank you.
It's what I call a mixture of the current fertility rates and the prior ones before they jumped recently. So it's 288 births a year. Right now they're at 306. Just a little extra, as a guy at the feed store says, there's no extra charge. Scenario four is a combination of 271 is what we're going to do in scenario three. That's the 10-year period of stability where births were. And you look at table one, you'll see that. 306 is scenario one. That's if you continued at your current rate, 306 a year, this is what would happen. Two was, as I mentioned, put there to put a cap on things. So the reason this is shaded here is we know the births for 21, 22, and 23. So there's no assumptions, there's no guessing, that's a fact. And we take the outcomes of that with retention ratios. From 24 forward, we have to assume what the births will be, and that's where the alternative scenarios come in. So if you take 2024 and you age it forward in time, the furthest that cohort can get by the end of the time period is to grade six. And those numbers are highlighted for all scenarios.
Can
the rest
I hear?
Of it is going to happen regardless in all scenarios.
Can I interrupt you for a second? Because the other thing is, I don't know if it's all out there yet or not, but Cool Springs, which would be Bethel Park School District, is building 50 townhomes on top of what they already have. Would that impact?
How many?
50?
Probably not, but if you got three of them, that would begin to have an impact. Townhomes are interesting. Many of them have student ratios of 0.25, which means out of 100 homes, you get 25 children. But there are townhomes, if they have place structures near them, that will be as productive in terms of the number of children as a single-family home in the neighborhood.
Yeah, Cool Springs is the one that's doing the miniature golf. They have the golf course. They have the indoor soccer fields. They have it all.
Okay.
Oh, I'm sorry. I just got a correction from somebody that lives over there. It's actually 64.
Okay, add 20 to that, minus one. You get 83 with Bethel Pines. That's almost at the level.
I just wanted to know how much of an impact.
There is a way. I do normally build in housing. They didn't mention this at the municipality when I was dealing with them, but that's my fault, not theirs. I doubt it will add a lot, but if let's say you got 80, in the next 5 years you got another 80. 80 is 80 a year, that isn't much, but.
Let's do this. Let's start with just have 80. How many kids? You know, what, 20 to 40 kids max?
Well, if it's a townhome, it depends on the kind of townhomes.
So yeah, right.
Again, if it's 80, one-fourth is 20 kids.
So mm-hmm. 40, you know, it's not going to.
I just, like I said, the question was, we were talking about only 19, and, you know, I forgot that Cool Springs had not built out yet.
There's those townhomes over there now, though. How many students are they renting
now? I don't know, but I do know that those are three-bedroom, two-and-a-half bath, two-car garage, very nice.
I've been recently touring all those with a friend who's looking for one. So many of them single couples are going into them, or middle-aged people. They don't want the maintenance of housing, so you're not going to see a lot of children in a lot of those places. At least that's what the realtors are telling us.
It depends. There are places where this is the first home, and it's mainly for young couples before children, or singles even, and some downsizing.
Mm-hmm. Right.
I saw a new phenomenon in Mars, for example, where we've got this high demand for housing, and a whole bunch of it is for middle-aged and older empty nesters. They're downsizing and buying new homes there. It's incredible.
Is the Bethel Pines factored in here?
No, because it's 19 homes. Right. It's factored into the analysis, but it's... I can deal with housing. I've got a methodology for looking at direct. There's indirect housing impacts and there's direct housing impacts, and I can sort the two and do direct housing impacts. In Cannon McMillan, where they've got a massive set of homes being built.
Right. If I may, I think it'll help the discussion. So if we had 64 and 19. And every one of those were sold to a family with childbearing women, and you used your average of 1.77, you're going to have maybe 120 people. So if you had max, you're going to add 120 to each of these scenarios, and you're still...
Yeah, still.
Yeah. Pretty
right. Bethel Park right now, we all know, if you're trying to buy a home in Bethel Park, you're bidding, there's three or four bids on each house, okay? That's what's going on. And I just didn't know if less than 100 dwellings would make a difference in any of these. I guess that was the roundabout question I was getting at. But I didn't have the numbers.
It could if it's, but I think it's still going to be a bump until you get a recurring set of such developments. If you get a recurring set of developments, then you'll have a baseline. Anything over that baseline will have an impact and bring in kids.
I know Baldwin had a high impact this year of 150 students at one time, but it was all apartments. They have a lot of apartment housing, and got a lot of them the immigration.
Uh-huh.
Yeah, so we haven't had those types of facilities.
Yeah, they have a unique ethnic group coming in. Well, I did a study for them a couple of
years. Yeah.
But Shelby, I think the other issue is, you have factored in some analysis about the likelihood of in migration based on overturning of houses, right?
not an analysis, but I've thought about it hard, and I keep waiting for it to happen. I observed it in Canonsburg, and I observed it in Beaver, both old cities. In Canonsburg, I believe it was the west side of Canonsburg that they began to turn over, and the young couples moved in, and the kids could walk to school, and they loved it. So they got an empty nester effect, and that was visible in the data. Same with Beaver, except it didn't split into east and west. But I haven't seen it otherwise. I keep watching for it. The key is that it isn't just a one-shot affair. It has to be recurring. Happens this 5 years, next 5 years, next 5 years. When that starts to happen, you get a cumulative effect, and it begins to tally well. So I talked about that in the analysis, but I don't have a way to calibrate it unless it's more obvious than what I'm seeing.
We've had a lot of our 30 and 40-year-olds. I deal a lot with that age bracket, and they seem to be buying the bigger homes in Peters instead of buying the next level in Bethel, you know. I don't know what the attraction is.
So it's, to some extent it was taken into account, but it was not documented. It was sort of, when I see it, I'll let you know.
But even Mr. Hayes said the worst case scenario, we're looking at 100 and some kids. I think you...
Instead of 4,000, you might have 4,150.
So not great. You know, we know we're not a can of Mac where they're going to have...
Okay, well, let's go into it very quickly. Scenario one, which is the current level of births, and let's assume they continue for the next 5 years at 306 a year. Now, that's not bad, given they used to be 271. So I think we ought to at least be positive about that side. The question is, what's the 10-year outcome for that? And the answer is, scenario one, 107 more children, more school students. But that's not... It's 184 less in high school and 160 more in elementary school. So it's partitioned in different places. And the biggest impact per student is at the lower middle school, Armstrong, where this scenario says it'll get 130 kids. That's 25% higher than it has now. Okay, table 17, scenario two. It's just sort of out of this world scenario. It is, there isn't a snowball chance that this will happen. I just wanted you to see, okay, suppose instead of holding at 35 a year, we add another 35. So in effect, you get 70 more kids a year. If I had that 35, then we'll get 334 elementary kids. 202 lower middle kids, Armstrong, one, Independence, and a negative 184 to high school. So the district would grow by about 350 kids. Now, that's key to 341 births a year. And we haven't seen that since, let's go on table one.
These numbers come pretty close to what PDE has listed.
I don't look
at that. Yeah, they are, at least I know, up until 2021. Yeah, they're pretty close.
PDE is doing 500 schools, so I don't fault them very often. What I don't like about their methodology is they'll take whatever direction the births are going and just add to it keep adding to it or take it away. Mm-hmm.
I was going to say, PDE is just a very simple logarithmic formula. If you have more births in your district than you did the year before.
Yeah, we had used them for the new school, and I've kind of followed them to see how close they came.
Gotcha.
They were right on for us, but.
Okay.
I mean, PDE between scenario one and scenario four, yeah. When we had pulled the PDE numbers, they're like kind of in the middle where you are. So they're somewhere between 285 and 310.
Are they expecting that growth? I haven't looked this year.
To try to help, once you have a report from Dr. Steumann, I would never look at PDE again. I mean, because again, I'm telling you, it's a very simple logarithmic formula. When you have more births,
well,
just bear with me.
Yeah.
It's just to put kind of encapsulate. They just, when you have a growth in births, your enrollment goes up over 10 years quite a bit. When you have a decrease in birth, it goes down quite a bit. There's not anywhere near the analysis here. So, third scenario.
One last point on that. What I have seen is that births are going up. It's not unusual for them to plateau for a while. They're going down, the same thing. And my preference is to let them plateau as to just keep driving it on up or down. So this one, I think, is not even close to going to happen. But it says that you might, if it did, you would get about 4,200 students, 4,250. But I see no evidence from the cohort analysis that you're going to see any increase, actually. I think it'll be a slight decrease. I choose scenario four. Scenario three says, what happens if you drop back to 271? It's worth considering, just like the cap of scenario two, this is the low point, I think. I don't believe that will happen either. But if you did, then the student body would decline by about 150 kids. 18 in elementary, positive still in the Armstrong School for 58. And bottom three are not affected by these assumptions because they don't reach past grade six. Scenario four is the one I chose as the most likely. It takes the number of births midway between the current level and the 271, the stable area. And so that's 18 more births, which gives you 288 births a year. If you have that, then ironically, enrollment will change by 15. Elementary still grows by 72. Armstrong grows almost 196. Independence still one. And high school is going to drop 184. I think that's almost certainly going to happen. So my ranking, and that's at the back of the text, is scenario four, scenario one, scenario three, and scenario two. Two is not likely because it says that you're going to get births that you haven't seen. I want to see table one just briefly. Got it? I buried it. That'll be right here. There's two. One comment and I'm done. Somebody have table one? Okay. If you look at the births, actually, they're going on. In the low period, you saw 320 in that range, 2000, 2004. In fact, the average was 316, slightly above what you got now. But before that, it was 345 and 411. If you look at the numbers in 95 to 99, I'm sorry, between 2010 and 2014, the numbers are around 260, 270. So we're higher than that in the most likely scenario. So rather than put it as a discouraging sort of sign that we're going backwards in births, I think that's reality, and I would be pleasantly surprised if it's more than that. But my take, and you can read the text, when I compared 2015 and 2019, the women population by cohort over time, there's a whole page on it, and it tells you why I think that 2019 won't match up to 2015.
I'm sorry, did you say you think it will be less? You said 2019 won't match up to 2015, you said.
Yeah, the 2015-19, table 7. 2019 population of women in table 7.
Got it.
At the top. Compare that with the 2015 population of women. And then if you go to quadrant 2 and quadrant 3, you can just stay in 2 if you like. If you look sideways, you'll see the cohort replacement. If you look diagonally, you'll see the net migration. When you compare the two, now remember, in the 20s, they migrate out. But two of the cohorts did not do that in this in table 7, and they were 25 to 29. In fact, one contributed to the bump we got now. 72 kids came out of that, and that was a baby bus group. But it was a baby bus with a flip due to in migration. The big 120 in that was a echo boom, echo one, and it was positive as expected. It had 152 more women than before.
Well, we won't see that again.
So if you look at those two columns,
right,
make comparisons, and you can go to the analysis and see what I was trying to do, I think you'll understand why the conclusion is 2019 won't match 2015.
Got it. Thank you.
Yeah, so let's just pull back a little bit. And again, I think we're looking at, you know, the most likely scenario being about 4,000 people. And, you know, if things go crazy and all kinds of births happen, you're going to get 4,200. So, you know, that's where we're at. And I think the big picture is, again, you know, what should the district plan for next 10 years? You know, probably you don't need to, you know, if you even if you want to be conservative, maybe plan for 4,500.
Right.
But you're not going to see 5,000. You're not going to see 5,500. You're not going to see 6,000.
You know, 4,500.
And 4,500 is very, very, very unlikely. Now, the good news for the district is the only, you know, some of the variables, I mean, I think Dr. Steumann really has nailed down your birth rate and your population and et cetera. You know, there is a little bit of a wild card of the, okay, what if houses do turn over? The good news for the district is that's not going to happen in a wave, you know, where 300 homes are going to sell to, you know, from an elderly couple to, you know, a young couple of childbearing age, you know, in 1 year. So you're going to see some increases, and what we always recommend is that the district administration take this most likely scenario, simply monitor, you know, how does your actual enrollment match that year to year, and you're going to see a trend before it becomes an issue for you, and you're going to have time to plan for that in what you're looking to do. So because, you know, when you look at these, Dr. Steumann had all your current births right now, you know, locked in for the next 5 years. So you already know what your kindergarten class, with very good likelihood, is going to be 5 years from now. So it's really that 5 to 10 year, and again, you're going to have time to monitor this and the like. But again, I think realistically, you're looking at, you know, 4,000 kids maximum.
Hadn't hit that level yet. So this is an optimistic. 3,800, 3,700 to 4,100 is the bounds I'd put on it, and I think that's probably reasonable. I think it's really optimistic. I think you can hit 45 without a housing boom or a sweeping set of young couples coming in, replacing older couples and empty nesters, which will be extremely obvious because it will have to be recurring and fairly large.
Right, and that's the important thing.
Delta. How many of those would have to turn over for you to get additional births? And it has to be a good number.
Doc, what's interesting is I believe our population from the last two census is still around 33,000 people. yet our school population enrollment is, you know, significantly less. So
that's the age distribution.
Exactly. So I mean, so those numbers are there of the population to switch, you know. But again, you're saying we'd have to have 300 homes switch from non-school family to school family.
Right.
I haven't calibrated the number, but it has to be significant.
I mean, yeah.
And recurring,
yes.
Yeah. I think Gannonsburg is not recurring. It happened in Beaver, but I don't think it's recurring. They brought in 100 homes not too long ago. That had an impact, but mostly because it was sitting beside 15 other projects, developments that were ongoing, which had anywhere from 50 to 200 homes. I mean, I just got a call from Trinity, and they said they've got a housing development coming in with 600 homes.
That didn't happen in here.
And that's big. Yeah. That is big.
So, again, just repeating, I'm clear on it, just so you know, the other people listening. We may get a bump 1 year of, like, this quick turnover, but yet it has to be recurring multiple years. That's a 3-4 year cycle. Recurring, what would you define that as?
Has to be ongoing every year, so that any 5 years you pick, you'll see it. And it has to go on for a period of time. I mean, ironically, the verse do too. We just don't think of them as recurring.
Right.
We just think of them, okay, it's at this level. Well, if it's at this level, it's recurring at this level. When you're talking housing, it's not used to it, but those are opening vacancies. I tried to, years ago, tried to look at stepping stones, but nobody has the data, and it's too difficult to get. As you buy your first home, everybody's got a record of it. You buy your second home in the same school district and so on. And then you can trace some of this filtering down stuff. I did research on vacancy chains of homes and jobs.
Any other questions or comments?
Yes.
Yes.
A lot of data.
I have a scenario.
Yes,
I don't know if this would, I don't know how you would know the numbers or how you would maybe come up with this, or if you can, I don't know if it's possible. But if Bethel Park moved into the future, let's say maybe offering a full day kindergarten, say that was something that was on the plate and that entices families to migrate here. If other school districts in the surrounding area maybe don't offer that, would that play a big role in the numbers to try to have more families come in, because it is enticing to have that as an option?
At most, currently it's like 8%, because you get that bump from at grade 8. But we're talking probably a bump at grade 1, grade 2. And you have that at grade 1. You have, I think it's 0.01028, about 3% at grade 1. You didn't pick them all up in kindergarten, but 99 out of 100 you got. But then you picked up some extra kids, and we know that there are preschoolers moving in, so that's part of it. And that's been steady for over a decade. That's pretty solid, even with part-time kindergarten.
That would be the parochial school kids doing the full-time kindergarten and then coming here for first grade.
Yeah. Or maybe some even private school kids that they liked going through kindergarten and decided they would end it at grade 1. Yeah.
Do you have a projection on how many students, say we had all these new homes, what percentage might go to a private school or a charter school? Do you allow for that?
Yeah, we looked at the percentage of alternative kids, and it's there. I'm trying to remember. You add the kids in alternative schools to the public schools, and then you get the distribution. It's It was 413 and on a base of 3902. So So it's right at 10%.
About 10%.
And then with COVID, it turned into 13.
Mm-hmm.
But I think it will come back toward 9.
Yeah.
This district has a good reputation. Yeah, it's there, because, I mean, I didn't know it was at grade 1, but I see it at grade 9 for some of the parochials and the coverage.
The other thing to keep in mind is, again, the recurring need to replenish students. So if you did have younger people moving in and having said that, that's necessary to keep recurring. Otherwise, in a few years, their kids are going to be out of your school. They're going to still be in their home, and you're going to see a drop. So that's where Dr. Steumann was saying that you could see a bump. You need it to be recurring for it to give you a long-term trend. And again, once again, if you monitor your enrollment, you're going to see that, and it's not going to catch you by surprise.
I'll give you a case in point. Kennemack was projected to grow by 900 kids. 450 of them were and migration from new homes and stuff, and 450 of them were due to the escalating births. While most school districts' births were going down, Kennemack births were going up until recently when they stopped. So you had 450 NMs and 450 E3s. That's the exit entry exchange. And that, when you add them up, that's 900 kids. What happened the last round that I did was they still have 450 in migration due to housing stuff, but their E3, because births have changed, is now negative 450. I'm sorry, I believe it's negative 150 or 200-300. And so that countered this in migration from housing, and their growth was much reduced, really, really significantly reduced.
Very good. All right, Charlie, thank you.
Mr. Hayes, one question, a little
sure,
off subject.
Sure.
Our high school was designed for how capacity, what level, do you recall?
I believe it was 1,200, 1,400.
The high school now? Oh, no, when it was designed, full enrollment, how many kids could that building hold?
Yeah, about 1,200.
So okay.
Grades at about 300, maybe, again.
All right, and just because... Well, my point is, I'm getting to is we're having this growth and conversation, but the high school obviously is perfectly capable of meeting any growth that would come down the road.
There now.
I'm thinking it's 1,600 we designed.
Yeah, I was going to say it's got to be 400 per grade level.
Yeah.
You had to build it for
that. Got 400 now.
I believe it was 1,600.
Well, you don't. You got 350 now, but
correct. And if we designed some additional capacity for the public areas, and then we also have the capacity to add. We just had an addition planned into the design in case that did happen.
If we did ever get a growth, okay, that's what I recall. I just wanted to make sure. Thank you.
All right, we're good. All right, Mike. What we're going to do is we're going to jump just in terms of time. We'd like to talk a little bit about the recommended work for the summer of 2021 this year. So in terms of the context, and I'm going to turn it over to Mike, is 6 weeks ago there was a concern that you might be facing a huge budget deficit, and so no new work was on anybody's radar. And then after Mr. McCausland's presentation, there was, okay, we might not be as in dire straits, and so the question last month from the board was there anything that the district should think about doing this coming year in terms of things that are current and existing needs, regardless of the master plan option that was chosen, in order to maintain the facilities that you currently have. And so we developed a document, and it is in your packet towards the back, might be the last document. That's a two-page document, and I'm going to ask right now. And we're going to talk about that. And Mike, I'm going to have you down. I'm going to just see Dr. Steumann out.
All right, so we're going to look at two things kind of side by side. If you want to take these photo pages and put them next to you after the it'll help you kind of see side by side what we're talking about. So the first thing, just in the general paragraph at the top there, is that we just looked at this for, you know, the idea is to not do any, to do the least amount of work needed at any of the elementary schools until you move forward and make a decision on what the master plan option is that you're going to move forward with. The items below here in the summer of 2021 are things that are in poor condition or are failing right now, and if you can, we would advise that you, you know, take on these projects this summer. And then there's a list after that of what maybe you would want to consider for next summer, and then on the second page after that is just a list of items in your elementary school buildings that are in a, you know, they're failing right now, but we don't recommend you do anything to them until you, again, you move forward with an elementary school option. So looking at the summer of 2021, the first paragraph in there is the paving at three of your elementary school buildings. So Abraham Lincoln, Ben Franklin, and William Penn are the three elementary school buildings we wanted to talk about. And, you know, the paving is deteriorated at those three buildings, is in poor condition, is getting to the point where it's a safety hazard. And you're going to have those elementary schools for at least the next 3 years, regardless of what master plan option you move forward with. So so you can see, really, in your photo pages, you can see William Penn. Condition. We just have a couple pages there, a couple pictures of what William Penn's paving looks like, a couple pictures of what Abraham Lincoln's paving looks like, and Ben Franklin's paving. And so the thought process here was just, we recommend you, you know, address these paving issues now. That way you can get the most bang for your buck as to, you know, if you decide to move on from these elementary schools, you'll get to use the good paving for, you know, now versus waiting for a couple years until it fails and fails further and being forced to do it and backed into a corner and you only get maybe a year out of the paving. So that was the reasoning for the recommendation. And then what we have here is kind of a range of costs for it. And that really, what we would recommend doing is have a civil engineer take a look at it and determine, okay, do we need to do a full remediation of the paving in these access areas, in these access drives, or can we get away with doing just an asphalt overlay over the whole thing? So that's why you see a range, the lower cost being just an asphalt overlay, the higher cost being if we have to take the access drives and do full remediation. So like I said, we have the three costs here for the three buildings, totaling $160,000 to $240,000 for the paving projects. Any question on paving? The next one on the list is it Neil Armstrong? There's a photo page for Neil Armstrong as well. The storefront windows at the front of Neil Armstrong at the main entrance are foggy and in poor condition. They're constantly in that state that you see in those pictures there, where you can't see through them and they just don't look very good at all. So what we're recommending is you just go ahead and replace those windows. I mean, there's no reason those windows will remain. There's no reason that they're going to go away. And if you can take on that project this summer, that's something that we recommend that you would do, is replace the windows in their entirety. One of the things I didn't mention there is this is likely due to the gasketing and sealants failing at the glazing, causing condensation in those windows that just won't go away at this point.
What did you say it's caused by?
The gasketing and sealants around the glass just failing and letting in moisture and heat build up in there and just causing the glass to fail at this point.
Any idea the age of these windows?
30 years.
Okay. Thank you.
Any questions there on the recommendation there on the storefront? Okay, the next one down the list then is VCT flooring at the cafeteria at the same building at NAMS. So approximately half of the flooring in the cafeteria is yellowing, it's discolored, and there's also a large crack going down the middle of the cafeteria. The discoloring and yellowing the flooring we think is likely due to that portion of the flooring being above the boiler room, and there's something happening where the boiler room is creating some sort of reaction in either the finish on the VCT or the glue underneath the VCT causing that discoloration. So what we recommend doing is, you know, develop a solution that takes care of the problem from the boiler room and then replace all of the flooring in the cafeteria, so it's all a uniform finish. It all looks the same and goes together versus having, like, these pictures are trying to show two different colors. It's kind of hard to see it on these photos, but there is, it is apparent when you're in the room that, you know, there is a yellow versus a white.
That was created for many years. I mean, from when I was originally there. But one of the questions that we had, and we decided to go forward with the tile, is whether or not, because the boiler isn't going to move, whether or not it would make more sense to do a finished concrete or something like that rather than tile to keep it, you know, because it's that area, and then there's also an area in the art rooms that there's some moisture coming from somewhere that's causing floor tile not to have its life duration the way that we would expect.
Yes, that option is possible. And one of the things we mentioned here is if the district wants to move forward, that should be investigated, right? We should investigate that condition more before we determine which solution to move forward with. I do think that the boiler room impact to the floor needs to be looked at, because even if you put a finished concrete in there, it could impact that.
Well, I guess my bigger concern would be, well, obviously it's a concern, but the bigger concern is what's causing the crack of the floor tile.
Yeah, that appears to be differential loading on the flooring, because that it appears that the structure bears on the wall right beneath that crack. And I think, again, the recommendation would be to put in an expansion joint there to allow that floor to move a little bit without, getting borne by the vinyl tile.
Is that included in the budget number?
Yes.
Okay.
All right. The third one down here switches schools over to Independence Middle School. We don't have any photos for this one, but this is pretty straightforward. And then the explanation is just there's a water main leak down the main corridor on the first floor. Currently, I mean, it's leaking right now. So we recommend you just go ahead this summer and take care of that leak. Don't let it cause any more problems. With a conceptual budget there of $20,000 to $25,000 to take care of that water main issue. And then the other item we had on here for Independence Middle School was the gym floor. The wood and the BCT in the gym floor is in poor condition beyond its useful life at this point. The gym's not going to go anywhere. It's going to stay in the district, for many years. There's also a little bit of an odor, as our understanding, coming from that flooring. So that's why we put it on the list here. If you can take on that project, just take it on this summer and replace that flooring and get rid of that problem. So it shows a conceptual budget there of $175,000 to $200,000 to take care of that flooring, which would include, determining and resolving if there is some sort of moisture problem causing that odor. And the last one is to take a look at resolving the water issues at the lower levels of the high school. Mm-hmm. It's our understanding that there are some issues with site drainage resulting in some water leaking into the building at the lower levels of the high school, and we would have to investigate this a little bit further in order to develop a recommendation as how you would mitigate this summer. But again, if you can take this on, again, might as well just take care of it this summer. The high school's not going anywhere if you can. So
There's been a lot of water problems around Ben Franklin, IMS, and high school, mainly because of the springs in the area, and also the original building at IMS, they diverted the water the wrong way, did not put the retention in. So the three buildings have a history of water issues from the very start.
The high school one seems to be the one that really bothers me. I haven't been down there for a while, Nick, but I've been down there before. And there doesn't seem to be a solution to that problem. And I'm not quite sure if it's an outside drainage issue or something in the chase wall or something. I don't know.
You know, it definitely seems from what Nick described that, and that there is something with the wall that's involved is essentially a retaining wall, you know, in terms of that lower level, and either the waterproofing that was put on, you know, on the outside, or the drainage pipe that's, you know, at the bottom of that wall that's in there, you know, maybe clogged. You know, there may have been some silt or something got in there. So I think that just has to be investigated. So the question would be is, again, for the board to think about, do you want to move forward with some of that work or not? And I think the issue is, because things have changed so quickly in 6 weeks, which is kind of bringing it to your attention in terms of these things, you know, are there for you to consider? You don't have to do any of them, you know, but if you want to do them, you know, they're good to do in the summer because they will impact the functioning of the building. And if you want to do them this summer, it would just behoove the district to move forward quickly because you're going to need, you know, again, because of the price, the cost estimates for some of the work, you're going to need to publicly bid the work, and it's going to take time to do that, advertise, you know, create the bidding documents, advertise it, get the bids, award it, and then have the people mobilize, and the summer will be upon you. So that we just want to bring them to the board's attention for that reason.
What I'm hearing, even though this is March, we're still probably behind.
Yes, you are. Right. Like, for instance, you know, the windows, the storefront windows, that's about a 12-week lead item right now in terms of, you know, aluminum window manufacturers. So when you work backwards from end of August, 3 months, that has to get moving quickly if you want to do that. So some of the work could probably, you know, bridge the beginning of school. But, you know, again, the paving, you know, if you're interested in the paving, that, you know, that obviously would be best to do before school begins, in the VCT flooring in the cafeteria. You know, again, it's just going to be easier for the school to function if that's done. So just wanted to bring that to the board's attention. And again, I don't know if you kind of started to talk about it tonight or continue to talk about it beyond that, but, you know, whether district was looking at, you know, taking it out on themselves or whether they would want our assistance with that or not. You know, our recommendation would be, again, for some of the things, it would be best to have professional specs and drawings in order for you to get good bids. You know, with the paving, you know, we talked to Nick and Doug, you know, our recommendation would be to get some core drills done by a civil engineering firm to confirm what your sub-base conditions are, because there does seem to be, in some of the paving, some sub-base failure involved. And you just want to know what's causing that so that you can bid it appropriately and protect yourselves. And we've been called into projects after the fact. One involved a paving project that went forward. They ended up finding organic material in the, you know, below the base that was being dug out, and ended up costing the district $300,000 because there was just that much organic material that it would have helped the district in that up front so that you could have got a bid versus being stuck in the middle of a project that is on a tight time frame and trying to negotiate the change order at that time. So
thank you for the information. We typically will have Nick and Mr. McCausland look at items for summertime work and come with a recommendation to us probably next month if there's anything in that list that you, Nick and Doug, and I don't know if Johnny Kramer would be involved or whatever for that. So thank you for that list.
Sure. And then on the second page, I think we, you know, in the interest of time tonight, we jump over the summer of 2022 work that we can consider that next month. And the other thing we just wanted to mention, again, the board asked last month if, you know, we may not move forward with a master plan option for several years, you know, what are the things that we found in the facility assessment portion of our study that the district should keep track of or keep tabs on? So we developed the list that's on the second page, the major systems or items that are beyond their life expectancy and could fail in 1 to 3 years. Again, our recommendation is that the district do nothing at this point. You know, you don't know yet until you pick a master plan option what's going to happen to the various buildings, and simply wait. But if you wait more diligently, it'll help you. And part of that is preparing, again, looking at your capital reserve, looking at these items, getting a sense of how much they might cost, so that if you had, you know, the HVAC system, the gymnasium rooftop unit at Abe Lincoln fail, again, you would have the means and the resources to pay for that without, you know, having a major impact on your operating budget. So that should be a capital reserve item. And again, the recommendation here is just that, again, Nick and the building principals would monitor those. So again, the board had asked for that, and we wanted to share that with you. So the only other thing, let me see if time permits. Yeah, so one of the things we did want to look at, and we'll do it briefly, we can pick it up again next month, but again, last month when we were talking about it, the idea of moving sixth grade to IMS, you know, was talked about. You talked about it again tonight. So if you go through your packet, you'll find there is a one-page sheet that says Independence Middle School Phase 1 renovation. So again, just for the board's in the administration's information, we kind of put together a Phase 1 renovation document that lists out, you know, what you would need to do in order to move the sixth grade to IMS. And the biggest part is, again, mentioned there, is the creation of the new sixth grade academy. And again, our recommendation in terms of, you know, using your money wisest would be to do the necessary work in that area so that when you would come back later to do the major renovation of IMS, you would not have to touch that area, right? You would renovate the electrical, mechanical finishes. You would configure the space for what you need it to be, and move the kids in at that point. So we kind of just pulled that together. And then also, as we had said, that, you know, in terms of the opportunity you were going to do that would be to renovate the main entrance to create a secure vestibule, because that's lacking at the current time, and then also install a new elevator. As we mentioned, our facility assessment determined that the existing elevator not only is past its useful life, it doesn't work well, doesn't meet ADA, all ADA requirements, and also doesn't serve all of your floors there. So again, we just mentioned, again, just for the board's consideration, and that's going to be a total project budget. You're talking about $5.5 million. And the other thing we just wanted to bring, and again, that's an all-in number. And the other thing to just consider in terms of a project of that size, so again, in terms of weighing this along with your, you know, strategic planning and what you may do and what you may not do, but in terms of looking at it, again, it would be in the district's best interest to look at bidding that project, you know, in December of this year or January of next year. You'll get your best bids from the best contractors available to do that, so that you would then lock it in and then in award that sometime in early February, and then look to, it will take 2 or 3 months to essentially have the contracts with the prime contractors selected, go through the shop drawing work that needs, you know, all of the materials and mechanical systems, electrical systems have to be submitted, approved, and then ordered. And then again, some of them will have long lead time items. So all of that's in preparation so that they can hit the ground running, you know, when school's out. And again, they're going to have essentially a 12-week instruction period to get a fair amount of work done. It's definitely doable, but again, proper planning is just going to save the district money in aggravation. So we just met, we bring it up just because, although it's next summer, and we're not even in this summer, you know, from the vantage point of doing a successful project, it should be considered earlier rather than later. So I just wanted to share that information tonight. Any questions or comments about that?
I don't recall off the top of my head, but is anything like this scope of work necessary to move fourth grade to Neil?
Yes.
This scope of work?
That phase one work would be necessary to move the sixth grade to IMS and create the sixth grade academy.
No, that wasn't my question.
I'm sorry.
Is anything in terms of this scope of work that you're recommending for IMS necessary at Neil Armstrong to move fourth grade up?
Not this level of work. But we would recommend, and thank you for bringing it up, Ms. Dobis, I didn't want to take the time, but in the immediate needs for summer of 2021-22, on the second page, we actually list recommendations for Neil Armstrong next summer if you were to proceed with that. So we can look at that for a moment. So, if the document we had looked at earlier, the immediate needs for the summer of 2021, the second page of that document, and I had kind of jumped beyond it and talked just about the major systems that need to be monitored. Above that, you'll see summer of 2022. And it says Neil Armstrong Middle School's fourth grade welcoming improvements.
Oh, okay, I see.
And again, the scope of that is totally up to the district. What we're recommending the district consider at a minimum, there are some educational improvements, you know, for the fourth grade going in there. And they're also, we would just think it would be recommendable to create essentially an upper elementary school aesthetic for the building versus what it is now. So what we're recommending is, you know, new finishes and new paint scheme for the lobby, as well as the educational corridors. We're also, again, recommend new signage for that building. So again, it looks newer from the outside. We approach it. So yes, and then there are some educational improvements that would be recommendable as well. Yeah, I think that would have to be looked at in a little bit more detail.
I think in one of your plans you talked about also with Neil with the entranceway.
Yes, and we could consider that again. Yes, we looked at
that. That's, you know, like that's even worse than IMS.
Yes, in terms of security. Yes. And again, we could move forward with that. You know, one of the things, if you did move forward with the storefront this summer, we would design that storefront with the addition that we showed you. It was actually as part of one of the plans that we showed you last night in the master plan options. But we were showing a new secured entrance with a new office adjacent to the entrance so that you don't have to go through the main lobby and have access to the entire school when you enter the building. And that could be built at the front of the building. And again, if we went forward with the storefront this summer, you know, we designed that storefront in order to accommodate the new new NAMS administrative offices that would be built at the front of the building. Is that the storefront, it could simply be interchanged. Some panels could be changed out when that change were to happen. So again, that could happen next summer. Again, that's where NAMS, you can make that project more or less depending on, again, what the budget the board wants to consider for next summer and the like. So that is possible. So Mojack, yes, you could do that as well at the same time. Very good. All right. Thank you, gentlemen.
Very good. A lot of work, a lot of information.
Yes, lots to consider. And take it from there. Very good.